Would you all please stand? Thank you. Take just a moment to welcome all of you to this memorial service for Paula Booker, and to Stan, Brian, the rest of the family, thank you for allowing us to be a part of this service today. Paula is a very special person to us. We love her. We love your family. And the reason I'm going to try real hard not to use the past tense of loved and was because of a couple of reasons. One is we still love Paula. Even though she's not physically with us, we still love her. Second of all, we also know that Paula's alive and well. So this isn't all there is. And so we're going to share in that today as a celebration of Paula's life, and also a celebration of her salvation and her eternal home now. And so I know the family would like to say thank you for everyone that's here in attendance. All of you that are on the live stream, thank you as well. And we're here to do two things today. We're here to honor Paula, but we're also here because I know Paula would want it and the family would as well. We're here to glorify God. And so that's what we want to do. So let us open in prayer and then we'll start. Father, in Jesus' name, we come to you and we thank you. We thank you for this time that we can gather here today. And Father, I know it's a difficult time for the family, for friends, for the church. Because, Father, we're going to miss her. But we also thank you that we can come together and celebrate. The Father, we know that Paula has served you well. We know now, Father, that she's with you and is more alive than she's ever been. So I pray, Father, your spirit would settle into this place today. That, God, you would be with this family. Show them comfort. And give them a peace, Lord, that only you can give them. So as we go through this day, I pray, Father, that your message would ring clear. We thank you again for your son, Jesus. And it's in his name I pray. Amen.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul. My soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation, joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my
thank you, Jeremy. I appreciate that. I want to take just a few moments and read the obituary for Paula. But after I've read this the very first time that I saw it, I realized this was not just an obituary. As a matter of fact, visiting with the family, I believe, Nancy, you're the one that said it was a love letter to Paula. And it was written by Stan, and there's so much in here that we can just glean off of this and see the relationship that they had and the relationship that she had, not just with Stan, but with Brian, with the family, and all of her friends and the church members. So what I want to do is I want to take just a moment and read what we have now deemed a love letter. Paula Jane Paulina Booker died on March 28, 2024, in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, at the age of 68 years and 11 days. She was born to Louise Trest and Jasper Paulina in Lawton, Oklahoma, on March 17, 1956. Paula was the youngest of three children in the Paulina family and grew up in a time when kids ran freely through the neighborhood. Her Italian skin would get so dark playing outside all summer, every day, all day long. Her family lived on 32nd Street, and the stories would abound of the great family activities of going on to the mountains for hikes, picnics, or trips to Grandma Tress's house in Cache. She loved to talk about her childhood. Paula attended John Adams Elementary, where she met Kim Carroll when she was six, and they have been lifelong friends. There was this new kid to school named Stanley, who had a crush on her, but she never noticed him. After moving away and going to different junior high schools, they would meet again, and Stan would be smitten by the beauty of this Eisenhower High School pom-pom girl. He would drive by her house every chance he got, trying to get up the courage to stop or even call her. One day she was in the yard, but he didn't have the courage to stop. She called him later and asked him why he didn't. The phone call, her calling him in 1972, would begin a 52-year love story. It's a good thing she had the nerves, right, Stan? Together, they would graduate in 1974 and marry in 1975. In 1980, they would begin a family by adding their son to the love story. She almost gave her life to bring Brian James into this world. He would be flown to Mercy NICU before Paula ever got to see him, and she would not be allowed to travel for 2.5 weeks. Stan would bring Polaroid photographs back to her to admire. Now, once allowed to travel, she never left the hospital until he was released. She was a protective mother and more than once told Stan he was going overboard on discipline or the delegation of chores. So there you go, mama always wins. But together they balanced each other out and Brian turned out to be a fine young man. Paula was always deeply devoted to anything in which her family was involved. When Brian was in children's choir and vacation Bible school and church, she always helped out. In the church youth group, she taught Sunday school. She was always involved in Brian's school activities, even when he was showing calves in the FFA. In visiting yesterday, they talked about her specialty with the calf, and it was decorating the tail, right? That made it look awesome. So that was her gift for him, was decorating that tail, making that cow look good. She loved creating special memories at holidays, especially Christmas. Such as when the family would cut down their own Christmas tree and watch old Christmas movies. Special family time occurred at a multitude of opportunities for her, from lunch every week with Brian, the last few years to travel with Brian and Stan, and when Brian was young, even going to Sicily with extended family and seeing the birthplace of her dad. Brian would marry Allison Stone in 2015, and Julia was born in 2017 and Anna in 2020. And one of the comments that, as I was visiting, is Allison talked about how welcoming Paula was to her, bringing her right into the family like she was always a part of it. And again, that shows the heart, I believe, of Paula. Paula would become Mimi, and her job was to spoil. She would often get on to Stan for buying the grand girls things that they would spoil them, only to buy them when even more herself. Paula would read them books and have tea parties. Whether on FaceTime or in person, it was always Mimi read story. She loved that sound more than anything. Now, while Paula traveled when younger, she had a very acute fear of flying that only got worse. It didn't help that when her first airplane flight, she got on the seatbelt and the belt came loose in her hand, which led her to white knuckles as she gripped the seat handles on takeoff. Then, when the family had a plane trip to take, she would torture herself by watching airplane disaster movies. What a woman. Later, after Brian grew up, she would refuse to travel when Stan wanted to vacation somewhere. But Stan would just get Brian to ask her to go on a vacation, and guess what? She always would seem to give in to her son. Amen. She announced after recent airline safety faults in the news that she was not ever getting on a plane again. But at an earlier point in the story, Stan would buy a private plane, and she would manage to overcome her fears to fly with him. And even once as far as Houston, and she even took flying lessons. But she would announce when the plane was sold that she was very, very relieved to never have to do it again. The important part of Paula's life, amongst all the family and things she did, as Stan, as you said, Paula got it. Paula accepted Jesus as her Lord and Savior. One day, she handed Stan her hymnal and said, "I know what I have to do." She walked to the front of the church and gave her life to Christ. She lived the life. Stan would say more than once, "Paula is the best example of Christ I have ever seen." Paula's story is a story of a loving wife, a mother, a grandmother, who gave everything for her husband, her son, and her granddaughters. They were her thoughts every day when she woke up, and she was always in the family mode. Paula was a very private and quiet person, which we all can attest to. She never talked about herself, but would spend lots of time going over her prayer list, praying for Stan, Brian, Allison, the girls, as well as other family members and other prayer needs of which she was aware, always praying for others. And I want to add a personal note on that, because every time I would see Paula at church, she would let me know that she's praying for me. For the 2.5 years of my battle, she, every Sunday that I'd see her, say, "I'm praying for you." And the cool thing about it was I never had to question it. I knew she was, because I knew Paula prayed, and I knew she cared about me. Like any love story, there were bumps, but faith and perseverance won out for a long, rewarding life together. After 52 years of love and almost 49 years of marriage, Paula passed from this life. She was preceded in death by her parents and brother, Tress Polina. She is survived by her husband, Stan Booker of the home, a son and daughter-in-law, Brian and Allison Booker of Edmond, Oklahoma, two granddaughters, Julia and Anna Booker, a sister and brother-in-law, Dr. Nancy Polina Ford, and her husband, Dr. Joe Ford of Bel Air, Texas, as well as numerous other extended family. So as we read this, we see again what an amazing life she lives, what an amazing family she had, and how much she cared. But this is just a part of Paula. This isn't all of her. So we're going to take just a moment, and I know Brian has written a few things, and he's asked his cousin if he would come up. And so, Chase, if you would come and read his story, I'd very much appreciate it. Thank you, sir.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Chase Underwood. As he mentioned, I am Brian's cousin and Aunt Paula's favorite nephew, and I apologize for those of you in the room who are just realizing that. as he said, Brian wrote some of these memories down over the last few days, and he asked me to share them, and I'm really honored that he did. 1 Thessalonians 4 talks about a life in, life pleasing to God. Verses 11 through 12 say, "And to aspire to live quietly and to mind your own affairs and to work with your hands as we instructed you, so that you may walk properly before outsiders, be dependent on no one." I can't think of a better example of these verses that my mom, from her first memories, she created a happy home for me and my dad. She helped her parents as they got older. She helped my dad's parents. She helped her close friends in need. She prayed. She did practical tasks and everything in between. My mom nearly gave her life for me when I was born. In truth, she didn't stop there. She selflessly gave of herself to her family and her entire life. My dad is completely helpless, and if you see him actually wandering around with mismatched clothes, please give him a little break. It's gonna take him a minute. My mom loved Christmas. From the time I was a little boy, she spent days decorating our house. No room was untouched. Sometimes it felt like no surface was untouched. As a child, it was magical. I loved when I got to help her. We would put on the Amy Grant Christmas tape, later the CD, and just decorate everything. And after I left home, it got even more extreme. She decorated before Thanksgiving. Then before Thanksgiving one year, she decorated the whole house for Christmas, except the entryway before Halloween. She didn't want trick-or-treaters to see Christmas decorations, but on November 1st, she finished the entryway. While she got into Hallmark movies like everyone else, her favorites were always the classics White Christmas, It's a Wonderful Life, and Miracle on 34th Street. We would watch those each year. My mom loved old movies. Maybe it started with her dad as he was a projectionist at the Vasca when he was growing up. When she was growing up, I'm not sure. She especially liked Alfred Hitchcock movies. I'm so thankful that mom, Allison, and I got to watch To Catch a Thief with her in the hospital in her last days. She smiled and chuckled. It's a sweet memory to have. She also enjoyed looking at photos and videos of Julia and Anna in her last days. Those brought smiles. My mom was so sweet, but occasionally my dad and I would do something that would elicit the look. My Aunt Nancy is probably one of the only person, and I see her shaking her head in the front, one of the only other people that's benefited off of receiving one of these terrifying facial expressions. The first time I was on the receiving end I talked back to her as a teenager. She looked at me and she said, "I'm not going to put up with this. You need to get to your room until your dad gets home." When dad got home, he didn't come in yelling and screaming. What I got was a speech about much love and respect my mom deserved. Of course, for however long I had been in there for the feeling awful for what I had done, he took me into the den and I apologized. After that, I was never able to talk back to my mom again without physical pain or thoughts of how much love and respect my mom deserved. I often apologized immediately after. Speaking of respect, you heard me mention Amy Grant earlier, and Christian music was certainly a staple around the house. But when my mom was feeling a little salty, she'd put on Respect by Aretha Franklin in the car and turn it all the way up. Psalms 119:11 says, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee." All of my growing up years, mom, dad, and I would sit in the room at bedtime for Bible story, prayers, and memorizing scripture. My mom instilled in me love and prayer and scripture. It's been a joy to pass these traditions on to my family the past few years. I've always had a special connection with my mom. I've never felt like she hovered or pushed too hard. She always gave me the quiet support and encouragement. And when that support became a little more vocal, I listened intently. More than once, I would tell her about something I was struggling with and would ask her to pray about it. And she would tell me that she had already been praying about it. She knew me so well. Watching my mom become Mimi over the last few years has been such a blessing. She loved Julia and Anna with all her heart. She cried with me on the day Julia went to the NICU, and later Mimi came to stay with us at the beginning of COVID, around the time that Anna was born, and she and Julia would form an incredible bond. Mimi read countless books, marched to the ants go marching one by one, and was a huge help to Allison and me in a very scary time of having a baby during the height of COVID with a young daughter we were told that was assumed high risk. Julia and Anna love going over for sleepovers with Mimi and Papa's. No matter the season, Julia would always get Mimi to read the book Frosty the Snowman. Read Frosty the Snowman. Her downtime always seemed to be sitting on the sofa reading a book to one or both of the girls. At our house, the girls had really gotten into tea parties, so every time Mimi came to visit, they sat at Mimi at their table and had a tea party with her. As I sit typing out this at her desk, I see the things most important to her: 4 devotional books, a photo of her reading a book to Julia and Anna, a photo of my family, and a digital frame with photos spanning her and dad, her with her family, all the way to the girls. Her faith and her family, nothing else was more important to her.
I want to share a scripture, because in times like this, and My family went through a very similar situation with my mother, and we sat right here in this church for her service several years ago. But I want to share a scripture that God uses to comfort my heart in times of grief, and thank God that he is with us, amen, and that he walks with us through the valley of the shadow of death. But in Psalm chapter 56 and verse 8, the psalmist writes, "You keep track of all my sorrows. You have collected all my tears in your bottle. You have recorded each one in your book." God cares about our grief, and he is with us. And that's why we can sing a song like this, "It Is Well." At the end of this song, I'm going to ask you to join me in the chorus of "It Is Well." But it is well because he is with us. And he intimately knows what's going on and is always with us. Amen. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. Glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. When my faith shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back like a scroll, the trumpet shall sound, and our Lord shall descend. soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Wow. My prayer is, my friends, that for all of you here, all of you watching the live stream, that it is truly well. And there's only one way that it can be truly well, and that is if you have the relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the relationship that Paula had. And that's exciting to know that through everything, it was well with her. And it is now well with her. And my prayer is that it would also be well for each one of you. I want to take just a moment to share a text here that the family talked about. Was one of their verses that one of the texts that they held on to. As a matter of fact, it was one of the first scriptures that Stan and Paula taught Brian. And it is, of course, a very familiar passage, and it is the 23rd Psalm. And so what I want to do is I want to read that, and then I want to share just a couple of things about this Psalm that I believe literally changed Paula's life and allowed her to live the life that she lives and be able to now serve and be with Christ. We all know this very scripture. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Now this again is a very familiar passage of scripture, and I was excited when they wanted me to share this with you. The problem with scriptures like this, though, is it gets so familiar to people. And we recite it, we talk about it, but what happens by doing that sometimes, it loses the effect of what I believe actually is meant to be here. And the thing about it, again, this psalm, is it's a very powerful verse. It's six, if you will, six verses that have absolute power to literally change people's lives. And I want to share a couple things that I believe, as I know Paula and the things that affected her life, how this scripture and this text meant so much to her, to you as a family, and should mean so much to all of us here this morning. And the first thing that we have to understand, this was a special verse because, again, it was special to them, but this is a song of absolute gratitude. And I think, unfortunately, a lot of times when we hear this scripture, it's in settings where people are sad. But in all actuality, if you read this, this is a psalm of celebration. This is a psalm of acknowledgement. This is a psalm of power. This is a psalm of peace. And Stan, I know, Brian, I know with the family, that's what you want, that comfort. You want that peace. So this text is so important to that. Because I want to look at three things that I believe changed her life and made her the woman, the wife, the mother, the Mimi, the friend, and the church member that she was. And changed and made her a great, great woman. I visited with the family yesterday, and we all sat around, and they were talking about, and they each kind of gave a word that described Paula. And a lot of it came sweet. She was a sweet lady. She cared. She loved. She was selfless. She was kind, accepting. But another word that came up that, I'll be honest with you, quite surprised me was that the family said Paula was quite competitive. Now, knowing Paula like I know her, I had no idea she was going to be a competitive woman. As a matter of fact, I thought she was going to be one like so many and help the people around her to win the game. But they said she was very competitive. So I want to look at a couple things here very quickly that I believe Paula held on to. First of all, and the most important part, was she allowed God to lead her in every aspect of her life. And Stan, you mentioned that. She was the most Christ-centered person you've met. But she allowed God because she understood the Lord is my shepherd. In other words, Paula said, I'm going to absolutely trust in that man named Jesus that was my Savior, and he's my shepherd. And she took that into her life, and not just to be in heaven, but to literally change the person she was, to become who she was. Because she understood, Stan, that God is in control. Even now, listen, my friends, even now, God is in control of all of this. And she trusted that. And trusting in our Savior is something that will literally change who we are. She also knew that he would meet her needs. And when we understand that, we gain so much when we allow God to do it. There's that peace that I believe Paula had through all things. Because she knew God was in control, and that whatever was going on, that God was going to meet the need. He was going to take care of the family. He's going to take care of the friends. And he's going to take care of her. Now, my friends, listen to me. That's valuable. Amen? That's valuable in life, knowing that God's in control. So Paula knew that. She also knew that not only would he meet our needs, but as a good shepherd, he would give us peace. Paula had a peace about her. And it was always evident. Even though through most of some very difficult times in our lives and in her life, she understood, and I want to share with you the family today, she understood that God was in control, God would meet the needs, God would also bring peace, and he'll bring peace to you today. Jesus said, I want to give you peace. My peace I give you, not as the world gives it, because the world can't give us peace. The world gives us peace for about that long until things change. But Jesus said, even through the most difficult times, I will bring you peace. He even described it as a peace that passes understanding. In other words, we may not get, how in the world do I have peace in this situation? Because it's a peace that Jesus gives. How did Paula have peace with everything that she went through? She understood that God was in control. And he brought that peace to her. And that's the peace I pray for the family. That's the peace I pray for everyone here. But also the good shepherd we see here gives us restoration. He restores us. He refreshes us. That no matter what we're going through in life, if we'll just turn to him, he will bring that fresh spirit to us again. Jesus even called out to you as a family today. He says, come to me. All of you that are burdened and heavy laden, come to me. I am the good shepherd, and I will give you rest. I will give you comfort. I will give you that peace. So this text shows us, first and foremost, that she allowed God to lead her in every aspect of her life. The second thing, it shows that Paula didn't, even though she walked through these valleys, and these valleys are difficult times, the thing about Paula that I appreciated, and I now understand even more, she didn't camp in that valley. She walked through it because God would lead her, but she didn't stay there, Stan. She sought the good stuff. She wouldn't stay there and feel sorry for herself. She wouldn't feel sorry for the things around her. She wanted to trust that God would lead her through that. And that's what the good shepherd did. He said, I lead you through these valleys. And yea, even though I walk through the valley, you notice he didn't say, I stop. And I camp out, and I feel bad about things. I sulk on things. I focus on the difficult things. He said, I walk through it. And that's what I believe was one of the great things about Paula, was she walks through that. She didn't stop. She didn't want to feel sorry. And one of the things that y'all talked about yesterday again was how positive she was, even in her speech about people. She always was encouraging. She was always uplifting. She never was talking negative about a whole lot of people. She wouldn't do that. And that, again, is because she wouldn't camp on the bad, difficult times. She let the good shepherd lead her through it. Because we all must walk through difficult times in our lives. This family, you're now walking through a very difficult spot. Friends, you're walking through a difficult spot. We as a church, we're walking through a difficult spot. But we all must do that, and we have these struggles. But Paula tried not to be held back, not by anything. Not even, and I laughed again when I read it, not even her fear of flying. She didn't let her hold that hold her back. She took flying lessons for Pete's sake. But everything in her physical life, and she'd had some struggles. But man, she let God lead her through that, Stan. And that's an encouragement. That's an encouragement to all of us. And the last one, she never lost sight of God's faithfulness. He says, here you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. And then he says, my cup runs over. And he says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That is a great testament to anyone who has faith in Christ. Is this one of the most valuable aspects of a Christian walk? Is realizing that God is going to take care of us. And he will bless us. He will bring encouragement to us. Even again, in very difficult times of our lives, God is still faithful. Can I assure you, family, God has not left you. God is not punishing you. God loves you. And he's faithful to you. As he was faithful to her, he's still faithful to her. Again, this is a very, very valuable aspect. Knowing that God is sovereign. Now, attesting to God's sovereignty, and I share this with the church a lot. It's easy to say that we trust that God is sovereign. It's quite another when we go through things and we have to then acknowledge, God, everything you do is right. Whatever happens, whatever you choose is right. That means sovereign. That means he is in control and his word is true. But then because of that, Paula knew, because of God's faithfulness to her, that God would also be faithful to the family. And he said that, and I believe that she knew that God would never forsake any of us at any time. That's what Paula believed, and I believe that's what made her the woman she is. Because she had that faith in Jesus Christ. And I know she would want me, as I wrap this up, she would want me to encourage each of you on the live stream. She would want me to encourage you to question today, who's in control of your life? Is it you? Is it something else out there? Or have you trusted and allowed God to be sovereign in your life, to be your shepherd, that he would have control of your life, that he will walk you through very difficult times, that you'll not allow yourself to settle in, and also know that God is going to be faithful to you? That's what this is all about. So you understand, even though it's so familiar that we almost lose track of it, again, these are six very powerful verses that mean so much. They meant so much to her. They mean so much to this family. And I pray they mean so much to you. God is good. God loves us. God provides for us. And listen, my friends, family, God will never leave you. He will never leave you, ever. I'm going to lead us in prayer, and then we're going to watch a video of Paula and the family. I want you to pay very close attention, though, to the final song of this video. This song is a song that Stan and Brian chose to put at the very end as an honor to Paula. Because what happened with a quick story, this song that you'll see at the very end, the last song was a song when Stan and Paula got married, was supposed to be played during the ceremony. Well, they didn't get played. And of course, Paula was not real happy about it. They didn't understand why it didn't get played. So what they've done today, in honor of her, the last song you're going to hear is the song that was supposed to be played during her wedding. So we're going to dedicate that song to her. Again, what another piece of a great love story, Stan, for you doing this. So listen closely to that last song, and I want you to know, and they wanted you to know, why that song is in there, and it will be something special. Let me lead you in prayer, and then we'll start the video. Father, in Jesus' name, we come to you, and we thank you for your love and your grace. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your comfort for us. And God, as we continue on in this time, I pray again for peace for this family. As we begin to wrap this service up, Lord, I pray that you would be with them. God, you would encourage them, and you would use the things that was done here today to bring peace to them and comfort to them and encouragement. Father, it may not mean much at this moment, but I pray in the days and the weeks, months, and even years to come, that what was done here today to honor Paula, to give out the message, Lord, that I know she would want, that God, this would help this family out. I thank you for them. I thank you for all the friends. And I thank you for allowing us to be a part of this today. In Jesus' name, amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. To my knees, will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Amen. In a moment, the ushers will be dismissing us by row. But before they do, the family is welcoming any that would like to come to the graveside service to join the procession to the cemetery. Thank you for coming. They want to express their appreciation for you being here because it's a testimony to Paula and it's a testament of your love and encouragement to the family. Thank you for being here. Continue to love on them, to pray for them, and to encourage them in the days ahead. God bless you.